Thank you, Mukesh, for that very insightful presentation. I think a lot of the points hit home on a lot of things. So a lot of good work on that. If you have any questions for the panelists, we have some time for some question answers. We can get into that. Nobody would like to have any questions, huh? Please. Can you just explain that the compliance and the price? I didn't get that.
Sir, they were taking advantage of the competition actually. Mm-hmm. So are they doing it in India also?
All the time. I mean, I haven't seen that stop. That they always do that. And in fact, I mean, this is not really the forum for compliance points as such. But I think there's more pressure on India always to perform and deliver. And expectations from us are always higher. And all is forgiven and forgotten when you get your price. So I think in a lot of the markets, the brands get a price and everything is overlooked, you know, at the end of the day. And I think Pooja is not here right now, but would have been an interesting point. I saw some studies recently on the cost of fast fashion, because she was talking about fast fashion, that it's actually the cost on compliance, on the cost on factories, on cost of things on the supply chain, that where is it actually going? So it's not actually a green practice in any angle or any way, and it is more harmful. And hopefully these studies will come out and we'll know better on it, you know. But today, if you're not compliant, if you don't do certain standards, and the buyer is moving for every 5 pence, cents, whatever you want to call it, you know, that's the case. I have Beta Sap, of course.
There's a question for Nitesh. You worked in Berlin for many years, which is a very high cost, very high labor cost country, and worked in an international group which has managed very complicated operations in that country. So when you look at the pre-production activities of an international company in a high cost, high labor cost country, and when you look at the pre-production activities here, what do you see as a major difference? How is the pre-production different then?
The pre-production, what we used to do, I think it will take 3 or 4 minutes for me to answer this question. First and foremost was the sampling plan was closed for next 2 weeks. We knew what is going to be loaded 2 weeks from now. What is the fabric flow for sampling? And there were different sets of samples. And we never had one operator making one sample. We always had a team of making samples. And we used to calculate on the basis of SMV, that what is the SMV generation out of sampling room. Here we are not even calculating SMV generation in the production floor. This we can discuss in detail whenever we discuss on production. Here we used to calculate SMV generation out of sampling room. How much SMV was generated. Any operation done in sample room, if it is not possible in production floor, it was the responsibility of the pattern master to come on the floor and set that operation. Sampling cannot get away just by doing any operation for getting the sample passed. These are some of the thumb rules we have to take, and it is really a bit painful in the beginning. Even the weld pocket, because the production floor we had weld pocket machine. So sampling also, no weld pocket was made manually. All the pockets were made using the machine. If there is no machine, mechanic will work additional hours on the night shift to set one machine for sampling, but they were not allowed to make samples by using manual methods. Sample productivity was calculated, minutes were minutes generated were calculated and monitored, and based on that they were awarded incentives. The incentive for a sampling operator used to be around 30 to 35% of his basic salary.
I'd like to ask something following up from there. Can you share some productivity benchmarks for sampling and patterns? For how many samples per tailor, you know, productivity, or how many patterns per master? Because I know we are definitely challenged by that always.
See, I can share with the bottoms. Like if you say bottoms, 5-pocket jeans with a contour 6 pieces waistband, the sampling productivity was somewhere around 7 to 8 pieces per day. Because in Bahrain, the hour average labor cost was $600 per month. That included his visa, his stay, and everything. So the production productivity was 32 pieces per day. So sampling was not less than 7-8. Otherwise, we could not have afforded to stay in Bahrain.
Peace.
Excellent. So all the three case studies what I shared, it was all related to lead time reduction in sampling, which did what reduced from 60 to 45, one case 50 to 35, and one case sample with development reduced from 12.6 to 9. As in the change management part, please have a seat. In my change management part, the first point was VSM and VAs and NVAs. Every activity, I said we have to challenge why it is happening, why we need to do this activity. Then you do value addition and non-value added activities. Plus one more thing, you have to see if we can run two activities in parallel. Why one activity has to wait for other one? So each event for improvement. It is just about analyzing your work and see how we can do better than yesterday. I was in a conference. I was listening to Rajiv Bajaj, the son of Rahul Bajaj, MD of Bajaj Auto. He took over Bajaj at a time when Bajaj was his worst. All his scooter production had stopped. Only Chetak was there. That also was in the fag end. Hero Honda was at number one with all the motorcycles. He took over Bajaj. And today Bajaj is in the presence of almost 40 countries. In all the 40 countries, either they are at number one or number two. They are nowhere in number three. So he was telling me that in his family, every person was educated from Harvard Business School, except the Rajiv Bajaj. He was the only one who did not go to Harvard Business School, and he turned Bajaj Auto upside down. So instead of studying all other models, what this model is doing, what this model is doing, let's work on our model, on our strengths. Make your model a model which somebody else can study. Work on your strengths. Everything is possible. Thank you. The practical problem is when you are managing a production, a person is doing same job morning till evening. Right? When you talk of assembly line, a person attaching the collar is attaching collars from morning till evening. But in sampling, you don't have one person doing only that collar attach. Maximum to max in India, generally, if you have a three people team or four people team making one product, it is considered to be a good modular line here. So that is why in India, the SMV monitoring is less. Or rather, it is practically becomes, you know, impractical to say which operator is higher efficiency. But yes, when you have a team of four people, you can have a healthy competition. This team on this kind of product is giving me this many productivity, this many samples per day. And this set of people are giving me this many productivities a day. When you go in further detail, you can have separate tailors for woven samples and separate tailors for knit samples. When this, if you are working only for woven, if you know the products, if your product range are somewhat limited, you can have people making for dresses, you can have different sampling tailors for making shirts and tops. Everything is possible. You only need to open your eyes and study the what are the strengths and weaknesses you have. My question to you, why you have alterations and rejection? Not maybe. Do you have a list? My dear, this is the problem. Until unless you know the problem, how you think of solving the problem? You get to know why you are having the alterations. Which team is making the alterations? Are the comments explained to them? Is the operator skilled enough to make that sample? That's what, hang on. You said they have added a tape which are not supposed to be hang on. So it is whole mistake. You recall the communication slide? Why they added the tape when it was not supposed to be added? You have the answer built in your question. You are not able to communicate to them. if the measurement is coming out, because maybe there are a seam, sometimes an overlock, you have a chain assist of stitch, so it shrinks. But your pattern master is competent enough to anticipate this, that on a 5-thread overlock, you have a double needle chain stitch as a top stitch and garment is washed. Definitely there will be some stitching. If your master is not competent enough, then it is your responsibility as a merchant. I'm not saying you, but I'm saying as a responsibility of merchant, when you have this problem once or twice, next time whenever you sample, you tell your Masterji, last time we had this problem, please ensure this is not happening. And you ask master, how will you do it? Will you build in some extra margin? Master will say, you forget it. Main keh raha ho jayega. That's fine. How will you do it? Just explain to me. Just show to me. Believe me, there is no rocket science. It's the only common sense which works in the garment industry. My first year used to tell me that this industry is run by all illiterate people. This is the time we have some literate people in the garment industry. So when those people used to run, can run industry, we are still much far off, better off this time.
Thank you for that, Sabira. And I think with that, we're coming to a close. If there are no more questions, and I'll hand over to Arika again. Thank you.